The drill press is an amazing tool for the simple reason that it has so many useful accessories. Not only is there an almost infinite variety of bits to poke holes with, you also have things like drum sanders, rotary rafts, plug cutters, countersinks, grinding wheels, wire wheels, abrasive pads, and of course, chisels. Now, I'm not just talking about these square chisels that are part of a mortising accessory. I'm talking about mounting ordinary hand chisels on a drill press and the amazing things that you can do with them. Ow. Back in the 19th century, there were huge tools called mortisers. They were tall, like this drill press. In fact, they were much taller, and you stood at them with your foot on a pedal. When you pushed down on the pedal, it drove a thick chisel straight into a board. When you let up on the pedal, a wagon spring retracted the chisel. If you did this repeatedly, you could quickly chop out a square hole, a mortise. These primitive mortisers gradually gave way to powered hollow chisel mortising attachments and machines like this. These are great tools, but they're expensive, finicky, and they take a lot of time to set up. Sometimes all you need is a hand chisel to do a little bit of precision chopping. So I built myself one of these. This is a wooden clamp that holds a standard chisel and mounts to the drill press quill. Secure the metal post at the back of the jig in the drill press chuck. Then mount a chisel, any chisel, in the holder in the front of the jig. Make sure that the chisel meets the work all along the cutting edge. The chisel should be square to the work, and you can check with a small square, although there are times when you could use just a little skew to help with the cutting. Before we go any further, let's talk safety. Every time you use this jig, you must make absolutely sure that the drill press is unplugged. All you need from this tool is the quill, the up and down part. If you should accidentally hit the switch and turn on the round and round part, well, things could get wildly exciting and potentially disastrous. And there are a few other things you should be aware of. If you make this jig from the plans that we offer, you need to check the distance between the quill and the front of the drill press housing. The holder must hold the chisel far enough forward that it clears the housing. On my drill press, I position the holder 2¼ inches, or about 6 centimeters, ahead of the center of the quill. That should be pretty standard for most drill presses, but check yours just in case and adjust the measurements accordingly. Also, the drill press generates a great deal of downward pressure. If you press too hard, the chisel slides upwards in the clamp. To help prevent this, glue a piece of a 50 or 100 grit sandpaper on the inside surface of the clamp. Don't use self-adhesive sandpaper, it's not strong enough. I found that wood glue works best. And reinforce the body with long screws so you can really tighten down on the clamp. To keep the chuck from turning as you work, put a wooden wedge between the bottom of the quill and the top of the chuck, just like that. Hand pressure only. Do not tap that with a hammer. You see, the chuck is mounted on a tapered shaft at the bottom of the quill. A little too much pressure, and the chuck pops off. If it does, don't worry. Just wait until nobody is looking and then put it back on with a little twist. As I said, you can use almost any chisel. You can even use a gouge if you put a V-groove in the holder. But some chisels work better than others. There are three major types of chisels categorized by the thickness of their blades. The thinnest are paring chisels. These have beveled edges to fit in tight places and are designed to work with hand power only. Although on this chisel, the Buck brothers put a leather washer atop the handle because they knew we were going to whack it with a mallet when they weren't looking. Framing chisels have thicker blades with no bevels and hoops on the butts of the handles to keep them from mushrooming as you drive them with a mallet. Mortising chisels are built for continuous whacking. They have steel hoops and extremely thick blades, often thicker than the chisels are wide. Not surprisingly, the chisels that seem to work best with this jig are mortising chisels. Paring chisels, and to a lesser extent, framing chisels, flex, and they seem to walk forward in the cut, even though you're driving them straight up and down. Mortising chisels don't flex. They hold better in the clamp, and they remain vertical in the cut. That said, let's make a mortise with this drill press. We're not going to chop out a mortise like bygone craftsmen did with their mortisers. The drill press quill would never stand up to that type of abuse. Instead, we're going to remove most of the stock with a drill bit, and then we're going to clean up the sides and square the ends with a chisel. Lay out the mortise with an awl or a knife, scratching the lines in the wood surface. Later, these incised lines will help position and guide the chisel. Using a brad point bit the same diameter that the mortise is wide, drill a series of holes to remove most of the stock from the mortise to be. Drill the holes at the ends of the mortise first, then go back and remove the stock between them with a series of overlapping holes. Unplug the drill press. This is important. Only when you're sure that all the electricity has leaked out should you set up the mortising jig and chisel. Use the fence on your drill press to help position the work while cleaning out the mortise. I like to use veneer shims to help advance the work as I flatten the sides. I position the fence to remove just a little stock. Then after I've removed it, I put a scrap of veneer behind the work and remove some more. I adapted the stop on the drill press fence to use as a hold down. This helps me retract the chisel from the cut. Continue until you've completely flattened both sides. Then remove the wedge and turn the jig 90 degrees to square the ends. If your chisel is wider than your mortise, switch to a narrower chisel. Continue removing stock a little at a time until the ends of the mortise are square. How do we do? Well, I split one of the mortises that I just made so that you can inspect the inside. And I also split the mortise that I made earlier with the mortising attachment so that you can compare. As you can see, the sides of the jig-cut mortise are reasonably flat and smooth. Not perfect, but pretty good nonetheless. Those that were cut with the mortising attachment are visibly rougher. Both would make good mortises, but the jig-cut mortise would glue up just a little stronger. And mortising isn't the only thing that this jig is good for. Remember, using a quill, you can drive the chisel downward with precision, but you can also get it to stop at a precise depth. With this in mind, Travis and I have been exploring traditional wire inlay. The wire in this case is not round. It's sometimes called cloisonné wire, and it's more of a ribbon with a rectangular cross section. Using the quill stop, set the chisel to cut a groove just a little deeper than the wire is tall. We're going to outline this small box with silver wire, so I'm using a fence to guide the work and cutting all around the circumference. And here's the inlay after we tap the wire in place, then wet the wood to swell it up and close the groove. Spectacular, don't you think? We'll discuss this decorative technique in depth in an upcoming video. In the meantime, the plans for this useful little jig are at our store. The link is either hovering over my shoulder or you can find it in the description. And as always, thank you for your kind attention.